US has provided the lead in the last 50 years in innovations and technology. US has provided the lead in the last 50 years in innovations and technology. Almost everything that we use today all over the world has roots in US. Computers, software, laser, biotech, nanotech, genetics, you name it. But a lot of these ideas also came out of defense funding. And as a result, a lot of it is not scalable because it's too expensive. For the last 25 years, I've been saying all over the world that the best brains are busy solving problems of the rich, who really don't have problems to solve. And as a result, problems of the poor don't get the kind of talent we need. And problems of the poor are pretty complex. Because you have to focus on affordability, scalability, and sustainability. If it is not affordable, can't do it. Take, for example, education. If education continues to be $30,000, $40,000 a year in college, can't scale it. Then it remains elitist. Can we provide education for $2,000 a year? Same with health. And that is where we have a huge challenge in India. Having learned a great deal of stuff here, and having seen the benefits of technology, I have been now spending a lot of time in India. To complete the story, I spent first decade in 80s. Then I had a heart attack, I had a quadruple bypass, because some of us then slept 3 hours a day. It was like being on drug all the time. Because we were building a nation. You know, we were in Prime Minister's office 20 hours a day, doing this, doing that, and trying to change this, and trying to change that. And we were young. So we abused our body. Didn't realize implications of it. So I had a heart attack, and then I realized that I ran out of money. All the money I had, I'd used it up. I had two kids ready to go to college. Son who went to MIT, Harvard, MBA, is a venture capitalist. But I needed to pay for their tuition in the US. Couldn't do it. So I decided to come back after spending 11 years in India. But when I came back, I had given up my US nationality to work for the Prime Minister of India. It didn't look right to be a US citizen because there was a story in the paper in India saying CIA has planted a man in Prime Minister's office. So I came back as a tourist, but you couldn't work as a tourist. So I started a business again, built a business, put my children through college. My mother was here, my father came here, they both died here in Chicago. And finally, decided to again look at India in 2004. Then I realized that the next big challenge in India is going to be talent. We just don't have talent that we need for the 21st century. You have a billion people, you have 550 million young, but you can't hire the right kind of people. Don't have plumbers, don't have electricians, don't have scientists, no mathematicians, no enough doctors. So we decided to set up a national Knowledge Commission, which I headed with about 9 of my colleagues. And we spent 5 years looking at the institutions and infrastructure India would need in the 21st century. So we looked at 5 aspects of knowledge. Access to knowledge. which include languages, translation, libraries, portals, networks, broadband, affirmative action programs, reservations, quotas. We looked at all education, school education, university education, vocational education, open courseware, distance learning, teachers training. Then we focused on creating knowledge. Who creates knowledge? How knowledge is created? Patents, copyright, trademarks, innovations, entrepreneurship. Then we looked at application of knowledge in government, health, education, small-scale industries, and agriculture. In the process, we realized that the most important thing is going to be e-governance for improving governance in the 21st century. And that's what a lot of the municipalities have to do going forward. Sum total, we looked at about 27 subjects. There'll be a recommendation, a letter from me to the Prime Minister saying these are the things to do. All of this is available on the internet. You can go Google National Knowledge Commission and you will see thousands and thousands of pages of documents on what we did, on how to build schools, colleges, universities, teachers training, portals, you name it. Then we realize that the most important aspect of the 21st century is going to be public information infrastructure. Earlier we built railroads and highways. Now we need to build public information infrastructure. And I could convince Prime Minister that we need to spend a lot of effort in building public information infrastructure, and this is something no private industry will do because there is no business model going in. There's a business model later on after 5-7 years. So what it means is that we need to build robust broadband optical fiber infrastructure in the country. So part of my job now is to really focus on public information infrastructure and innovations. So we are doing series of things which I believe are going to be very important even to the US. So when Mr. Obama was in India in November last year, he and I spent half an hour. I told him about what we are trying to do, and he was pretty impressed. He said, Sam, this is pretty courageous. He said, I don't know how you think like this. And I said, we have no options because we got billion people to deal with, 1.2 billion, 15 different languages, lots and lots of complexity, contradictions, diversity. And how do you hold all of this together? I'll never forget when I went to Russia, then Soviet Union, for the first time in 87. We were meeting with some leaders along with Gorbachev. And one of his colleagues told me, he said, you know, Mr. Petroda, what we really admire about India is how you hold this country together without guns. He said, we have guns all over, machine guns, and we can't hold Soviet Union together. How do you do it? He said, you got such a diversity. Different religion, different race, different languages, but somehow everybody hangs together. And that's why we need to keep that in focus in every part of our programs. So as a result of our conversation with Obama, Mr. Obama, we decided to launch a joint program between the US and India. We took 15 people from our team, 15 from White House, and build open government platform. It's already announced. I was in Washington in August or so. Hillary Clinton and all of us were together and we announced this platform. This platform is now going to be available to all countries free of charge. Open source, developed jointly by US and India, to really open up their government to radicalize their democracies. The idea is to really basically democratize information. Information is power, not many people like to share. And we believe for us to push democracies, we need to really radicalize information infrastructure. So we have two major networks that we are building. One called National Knowledge Network to connect 1,500 nodes with 40 gigabit bandwidth to connect all our universities, all our libraries, all our R&D institutions in India. That network is connected to US with optical fiber. So US universities can interact with Indian universities. It is connected to EU and it is connected to Japan. So I can listen to a professor from University of Chicago and broadcast to 5,000 colleges in India today. It cost us $3 billion. It's all built, it's working today, but people don't know how to use it. They have no idea, what do you do with all this bandwidth? So one day I decided to find out, because I also don't know what to do with 40 gigabit bandwidth every day. So I talked to a friend of mine at Stanford University, he's a physicist, and he said, Sam, I use 40 gigabit bandwidth every day, 24 hours a day, between Stanford and Europe. So there are scientists who know how to use these things. We are beginning to learn to use these kind of highways. All set up. Second network we are building at the cost of $6 billion is to connect 250,000 local governments to optical fiber. It's already underway. It will be all built in next 18 months. We have mapped every little fiber in the country. We have 1 million kilometers of fiber, and we are adding 400,000 kilometers more for last mile connectivity. When that happens, every local government will have hundreds of megabits of bandwidth coming in. But people say, well, you don't have water, you don't have education, what do you do with optical fiber? That's the challenge. The idea is keep doing it and something will happen. If you have answers to everything, nothing will happen. I must give credit to the government that they have been able to put political will behind it. And without political will, these kinds of things cannot be done. So along with these two networks, NKN and optical fiber network, we have a program to identify and tag every resident in the country. 1 billion people are being given unique ID with fingerprints, iris, photograph. That program is underway. We have 200 million already documented. And by end of December 2013, 690 million will be documented. Massive program. The idea is to tag every human being. And there is logic to it. Then we have another program called National GIS to tag every physical asset. The UID is going to cost us about $3-4 billion. GIS will cost us about another $2 billion. Where we want every physical space, because today in India we have lots of maps. Water department has their own map, power department has their own map, revenue department have their map, everybody's doing their own thing. So we said, stop it. We need one set of maps. So we have 30 departments come together.